Hello, good afternoon, sir. My name is Prashant, Kumar, Singh, and my topic is interactive ebooks on Aakash Tablet. So in this presentation, I will be explaining the work done in MTP first phase, that is the ebooks I created and the literature survey that I did in this sem. So this is the table of content. First of all, I will be explaining the introduction and the motivation section. So the introduction. So we are living in an age of science and technology, and so the science and technology has made an impact on every aspect of our life. We use various technological devices in our daily life. So the field of education has also not remained untouched with the effect of science and technology. We can see the effect of technology in our daily life. Like, the effect of technology in education can be summarized in the following points. There are smart classrooms now where the children can read with the help of computers, and the teachers can demonstrate with the help of interactive demonstration in the class, so the student can get the concept better. So the second one is e-learning, where a student can learn the concept itself on internet by searching through the various topics available. So the books have also turned digital, so the e-books are available that we can read on any small handheld devices that supports e-book readers. So there are various course management systems like Moodle that are available that helps a teacher to manage a course that is running on a large scale. And there are various online courses available like Coursera and NPTEL, where a student can learn and the courses. So learning by ebooks. So learning by ebooks is a recent concept, as the technological devices are increasing, the number of ebook readers are also increasing. So but there are several limitations that are available when we read ebooks on a tablet. Like, suppose a young age children is reading a book on a tablet, so he might feel it more interesting in like playing games than playing games or watching videos or movies on the tablet than reading ebooks. So suppose he read one or two pages and then he might get just distracted, and he might want to play some games or may want to hear some song. So there are more chances of distraction. So the second limitation is that there are no interactive demonstration available on ebooks. So if I am reading something that is totally new to me and that requires a lot of visualization power, so I will not be able to explain without any interactive demonstration. So verbal, so as we will see further, that the verbal symbols that the usual talking and seeing, that they don't leave a concrete experience on a user. So motivation of my topic is to remove all those limitations that I described in the previous sections. So to remove all those limitations, there came the concept of interactive ebooks. So the interactive ebooks provide certain additional features in compared to ebooks. The features are as follows. The interactive ebooks enable a reader to communicate with ebook. So a reader can read a ebook, he can solve quizzes on the ebook, and he can watch videos or animation in the ebook. So he can communicate with the ebook. So these books contain embedded interactive multimedia material. Suppose these books contain animations, these books contain videos that make them interesting to read, and user feels themselves engaged with the book. So the interactive ebooks make a user able to learn not just by reading, but by watching animations, by solving quizzes, and by playing videos, etc. So they provide a better learning environment as compared to the normal ebooks. Learning is a process of gaining knowledge. So we learn with the help of our sensory organs. Suppose we see something or we hear something, then that comes through our memory and we learn that thing. So various sensory organs are involved in the process of learning, like eyes, ears, all these sensory organs are required. So there are learning hypotheses. There are two possible learning hypotheses. The first one is the passive learning hypothesis, and the second one is active learning hypothesis. According to the passive learning hypothesis, if the taught content that is taught by a teacher is same, then learning will remain same, So it actually says that if the two teachers are teaching the same concept and but they both follow a different style of teaching, then the learning will remain same, as learning doesn't depend on the way of teaching, it actually learns on the content to be taught. But active learning hypothesis says that the way of teaching is also a major factor in learning. So if a teacher is teaching it differently, then a student will be able to learn it in a much better way. So according to the passive learning hypothesis, multimedia or interactive objects play no role in learning, but according to active learning hypothesis, these create a major impact. So I will be further explaining the cone of experience and the forgetting curve. So the cone of experience. The cone of experience was given by Edgar Dell, that was a famous educationist. He studied various audiovisual methods that are required for experience. So the cone was mainly divided into three regions. The first one was symbolic, the second one was iconic, and the third one was inactive. So the symbolic regions tell that whatever we see or whatever we hear. So the top layer of the pyramid gives the least concrete experience, while the bottom layer gives the most concrete experience. So if we are according to this cone, if we are reading something or we are listening something, then the concept is not very concrete, it is abstract. So and the second one, iconic region, it involves that if we are watching something, like if you are watching a movie or if you are watching a demonstration performed by someone, then it will give a better concrete experience. And the third one is inactive. Inactive means knowledge that comes by actions or when we do the same thing. So suppose we are doing the same thing what we want to learn, then we will get a better learning experience. So according to it, if you are performing a thing, if we are doing that thing, then it will give a better experience. So the forgetting curve is given by Hermann Ebbinghaus, a German psychologist. This curve gives the relationship between the memory and the time remembered. So suppose I learn something at 0th day, then the process of forgetting is shown by this red curve. So suppose I learn something at 0th day, then the process of forgetting starts from the very next moment that we learn. So the process of forgetting just start after that moment. So suppose here I learn something, then I start forgetting that thing in an exponential loss of information. So suppose I learn something, then I will lose that information completely from memory after few days. So the red line explains the exponential loss in the information. The green line explains the concept of when we revise the same thing. Suppose I learn something and then I learn something at 0th day, then I revise the same thing at the beginning of the first day, then the remembrance of that concept will come to at the top, and we can describe we and that will come to top and it will save in our memory. But even after that, if we don't revise that concept, then the forgetting will start. So suppose that at the beginning of the second day I revise that topic again, then that will become more permanent and the rate of loss of information will become less. So like if I keep doing this for next several days, then that concept will become permanent in our memory. So effect of interactivity. So I will be explaining an experiment done by Evans and Givens. The aim of this experiment was to investigate the impact of interactivity on students. So several students were selected from a college of London University, and the students were selected in such a way that none of them has a background in physics. So this experiment was performed in 2007, and 33 students were selected from a college in London University, and they all were taught a concept of working of a bicycle pump. So the students were like that, none of them had a background in physics. So this was the experimental setup. So the methods. So the group was randomly divided into two parts. The first one was I group and the second one was NI group. I group means interactive group, while the NI means non-interactive group. So after they were given, the I group was taught using the NI group was taught using the traditional method, while the I group was taught using an interactive simulation. So after that lesson, both of the group were given two quizzes to solve. The first one was the memory test that contains two questions, and these questions were mainly to check their retention power or how easily they can recall the facts. So this was mainly to check their recalling power. So the questions were simple that were taught in the chapter. The questions were like that, how a bicycle pump works. So they were actually taught in chapter that how a bicycle pump works in two phase, in up phase and down phase. The up phase contains 6 stages and the down phase contains 6 stages. So the questions were directly from the concept that they learned in the lesson. The transfer test. The transfer test was mainly to check their critical ability, critical thinking power of the students. Suppose a student learns something and how can he apply that in his daily life, that was checked to check the transfer test. The transfer test contained 6 questions and the questions were like what could be done to make pump more effective, to make it move air more rapidly. So the questions were how they think critically and that the duration for the both and test for 1 hour each and the time was recorded both for the test and both for the lesson. So this is the screen for non-interactive group. So the non-interactive group was sent to a lab where he can see some slides. This is the first slide where a student sees the working of a pump. So it is the down phase while it is the up phase. So here it says that the down phase contains 6 stages and up phase contains 6 stages. So this is the first phase. As we press the pump, so the piston goes down, the inlet closes, the air compresses and the air goes out of the pump. So like these 6 stages were taught from this chapter, and similarly there were 6 stages in the up phase. So all these 12 stages were taught to the non-interactive group, but the screen was totally different for interactive group. So this is the screen that was shown to interactive group. So there was a previous button, there was a repeat button, there was a next button on that screen. So suppose if I am seeing the first stage on the screen, so if I am pressing the piston and so after that I press the next button, then next stage will come to my screen so that I can see that I can see all the stages in 12 steps, or even if I want to repeat that step, then I can see that step on my own, or if I want to go to previous step, then even I can go. So this makes the students learn at their own pace. So suppose I take time to get the things, so I can watch this slide at more time, and whenever I press the next button, then the next screen will come. So the observation that the other kids was that there was no significant difference in the memory test, and but there was a lot difference in transfer test time, transfer test scores. So these are the scores that interactive group got 2.5. These are the main scores, 2.5 out of 6, but the interactive group got 1.8 out of 6. So this shows that the interactive group was able to apply those knowledge in, was able to more critically think those concepts. Time taken, so the interactive group even take less time to solve the quizzes. Mean time for interactive group was 75 seconds, but for NI group it was 1160 seconds. So these are the observations. This is the lesson time, this is the overall test time. According we can see that the dot, that circle represents interactive group, these are the interactive group, for delta represents the non-interactive group. So the interactive group students take less time on learning lessons, but they take significantly less time in solving quizzes, as I shown previously with the help of figures. Similar work, this is the similar experiment to check the effect of interactivity on students. It was done by Saswan, Nusiri et al. And others, and also so the aim of this experiment was to check the effect of multimedia on student learning ability. So he selected several students from grade 1 in Jordan. So all of them was taught simple concept of mathematics using one was traditional group who was taught using traditional method, while second was multimedia group who was taught using animations, videos and cartoons. So cartoons were simply used like the Tom and Jerry cartoons so that a student might find it interesting to watch the videos. So simple mathematics concept was taught, that was fraction principles. So test was organized after this to check the effect. So the mean scores for the traditional group was 8.05, while for multimedia group it was 8.47. So the cartoons were used to teach, and the other feels that cartoons make it more students feels more engaged and more interested to read the chapters. Animation in learning. So animation in learning, the author Ricardo Mayer, who was a famous educationist, says that the using animations alone in education will not be able to give fruitful results. We have to represent animation in a certain way that make it possible to represent in to give best possible results. So according to him, we have to use animations in a certain manner. How to represent animation, that is what he taught using these principles. So he represented these principles in these seven principles. According to whom, the first one is the multimedia principles. Is according to it, the animations should be used. The narration alone is not sufficient to teach best. A special contiguity principle. Suppose I am teaching something and the animation is available, but suppose I am teaching the first chapter and the animation is available on the third chapter, then it will not be beneficial for the students. Animation should be close to the text that is taught. Third one is temporal contiguity principle. According to it, tells the time difference. Suppose I am teaching something through narrating and the animation is presented after that, this should be not be the case. Animation and narration should be presented at the same time. The fourth is coherence principle, means if we are demonstrating something and it contains some irrelevant sounds like some background sound, background noise, so it means it says that it contains negative impact on students. It may lead to distraction to students, so it must be removed. Modality principle. Modality principle shows that which mode should be selected. Suppose I am teaching something through animation and narration, then it will be more efficient than using animation with text. So redundancy principle, as I told in modality principle, that animation with narration is more effective than animation with text. So the redundancy principle says that if you are using animation and narration, and then there is no need to use text is redundant in that case. Personalization principle says that if I am using the conversational style of conversation in class, like I am saying, suppose I am doing this thing, suppose you are going to market, then the student may be able to, small children may be able to visualize it better, as they may feel that they are doing the same task, they may feel that they are actually doing, so they get it better in conversational style than in formal style. Interactivity in ebooks. The technology has made, with the advancement of technology, the books have turned to ebooks. So we can read them on any tablet devices, we can read them on smartphones, but the ebooks are just a printed version or digital version of books. So they lack the interactive features. We cannot watch videos within the books, we can not attempt any quiz, we cannot watch any animation in the book. They are just a printed version. So within few years, the technology has grown so much, but the effect on education is still not so impressive. Suppose we see still in various colleges, the chalk and talk method is used, where a teacher is simply using chalk and narrating some concept. So there came the concept of interactive ebooks that provides certain additional features as compared to ebooks. So these features can be summarized as support for audio and video content. So a children may be able to watch videos, audios within the book. So these are embedded in the book. Support for SVG. SVG means scalable vector graphics. These are the images that can be zoomed to a much larger level without any loss in information, without any degrade in quality. Support for in-book quizzing. So these books may contain quizzes within the book so that we can demonstrate, so that we can check our learning capability at the end of the quiz, at the end of the lesson. Support for reflowability content. These ebooks contain reflowable content. Suppose I am reading something on my mobile phone and something that same thing on my tablet, then it will display both the things, the same book differently on both the devices. Better educational environment. These books provides better educational environment as a child may feel it more interesting to read on a book that contain animation, that may contain videos, that may contain quizzes. So they are interesting to read. So spoken tutorial is a program that is going on in an IIT Bombay. So these are less duration programs, less duration videos that are used to teach some particular topic. So they contains the video of some slides that is narrated through some narrator. So the main feature of this is that audio language can be changed to any of the language. So suppose a person who has poor English, even he will be able to learn through these videos. These videos will be displayed in his local language. So the narration in these videos will be narrated in Indian accent that makes a user feel that he will be able to grasp the things more quickly on learning at a speed that suits you better. ePub. Now I will be narrating an ebook format that provides interactivity to ebooks. So it is an open standard ebook format so that anyone can use it freely. It is free and open, and it supports interactive features like audio, video, and the file extension for ePub is .ePub. So suppose there is a book named some ABC, then it will be abc.epub. So versions of ePub, there are two versions of ePub available. So the previous version was version 2.0.1, and the main feature of this version was to just provide replayability. So if I am seeing the same content on my mobile phone and same content on a computer, then it will suppose that on my mobile, that is a small screen phone, it shows the first line is my name is ABC. But if we are seeing the same content on a tablet or in a small mobile device, then if the screen is only able to fit the only my name and is ABC is not able to display it properly, then it will automatically come to next line. So the main feature of it was to replay the content. Version 3 is the current version of ePub. So it allows various formats, various facility. It came into existence in year 2011. So it supports the embedding of audio and video. It supports MathML features. It supports CSS3. It supports the involvement of CSS3. We can give a better design to our page. With the help of MathML, we can embed math equations within the page without using images. So it is actually HTML5 that gives us all these features. These also support SVG, scalable vector graphics. So now I am describing the structure of ePub. So actually ePub is a zip archive of some files. There are mainly one file that is MIME type in Word, and with two directories, that is OEPBS and MetaInf. So there are mainly one file and two directories that contains various files inside it. So the one file is the MIME type. The MIME type file only contains the MIME type of ePub. So MIME type is a unique identifier of any file on the internet. So the MIME type of ePub is /ePub/zip. So it actually tells that it is an ePub file. So if this is a book, that name book.ePub, then it will be having a MIME type, a MetaInf directory, and a OEPBS directory. So the MetaInf directory contains only a single file that is named as container.xml. So the container.xml is an XML file that contains the path of the file that contains all the address of all the things that are being required for the book. So it contains the address of content.opf, which in turn contains the address of all the files that we need for the book. So it gives the file of the root part of the root file. So OEPBS directory, this directory contains all the files that we require for the book. So suppose there is a directory for images, there is a directory for videos, there is a directory for CSS, there is a directory for HTML files. So all these contains images, contain all those images which are required for the book, video, all those videos for the week, CSS contains all the CSS data that we used for the designing of the book, and all those HTML files that we use for the book. So there are two files extra involved. That the first one is the content.opf and the second one is the toc.ncx. So the both of them are XML file. The content.opf contains the all the addresses of the all the files, like all the addresses of all images file, addresses of all video files, etc. So it contains all the address, it contains all the MIME types of all the files, it contains the meta information of the book, like what is the name of the book, what is the name of author, in which year it get published, like all these information. So it contains the meta information, even it contains in what order the things should be displayed. So it tells exactly that the first page should be the cover page, the second page should be the table of content page, etc. So the other file is toc.ncx. toc.ncx is a XML file that tells what is the table of content for the book. So all these files are required for creating an EPUB ebook. That is that EPUB 3 book that provides the features of audio, video, animations, etc. So meta MIME type is a identifier that is used to identify a file uniquely over internet. So meta INF contain only a single file container.xml that contains the path of content.opf. The second directory is oepbs that contains all data files, and it contains two files, content.opf and toc.ncx. So it gives the all the metadata, that what is the name of the book, what is the name of author, in which year it get published, etc. and addresses and MIME types of all data files. It also tells in what order these contents should appear in a book, like the first one should be the cover page, the second one should be the table of content, the third one should be the chapter one, like this. So interactivity in EPUB. So now with this topic I will be explaining how we can embed interactivity in a book.
Pauch karna.
ऐसे दिखाऊंगा तो दिखेगा थोड़ा, चल तभी ऐसे बोल देता हूँ. So interactivity in EPUB. In this section I will be displaying the ebooks that I created during first stage. So this is the book that I created on Aakash tab. So it is not able to, so it contains a chapter. This is the table, this is the cover page of the book. This is the first page. So in this book I will be explaining the concept of sorting through this book. So this is selection sort. Suppose this is the black portion is an embedded video that we can play, and with these topics I will be continue further for a quiz that is embedded within the book. I will display this book during presentation. So these are the snapshots of the book that I created. So here it is a video that explains the story. So this is the quiz portion that will be displayed at the last of the chapter that a student can attempt to quiz within the book. So the first question is complexity of selection sort algorithm is, so suppose he gave a wrong answer, and the second question is complexity of insertion sort algorithm, suppose he gave a right answer, that is O(n) square. So if he will click at the get score portion, he will see his score that he attempted one question out of two correctly, so he will get a score of 50%. So authoring tools for ebooks. So what are the tools that are available for creating ebooks? So the first tool that is very good I found is iBook Author. It is a tool by Apple and it is a proprietary tool. So anyone that uses a Mac can use this tool for creating ebooks that works only on Mac. So the second is the PubSoft. It is a free to use online tool that is used for creating animated books that works only for iPad and iPhone. So the interface is very simple and it is mainly meant for a non-technical user. So interface is based on drag and drop, so we can easily create an interactive ebook using PubSoft. Sigil, it is a tool that is open source and it allows the visivig editing of ePub book. It also allows creation of ePub 2 books. So problem strategy and solution. So problem statement that I found is in second page I will be discovering some other possible ways of giving interactivity to ebooks. So in this same I discovered some of the ways like adding videos, adding animations, adding interactivity, adding quizzes. So in the second same I will continue it further to discover other possible ways, and I am thinking to create a tool that will automate the process of creating interactive ebooks. As we have seen in the previous slide that there are limited tools available and most of them have certain restrictions or limitations, like if I am creating any book using PubSoft then it will work only on iPad and iPhones. So I am thinking to create an authoring tool for ePub books that will automate the process and that works good for Aakash Tab. So solution strategy. In the second sem, I will explore HTML5 and JavaScript in a much better way to explore all the possible ways that can be used for providing interactivity. I will create an automation tool that takes text and interactive media as an input and will provide an interactive ebook as output. So this is the last slide conclusion. So I will conclude with that the interactive ebooks is a recent concept of education. So there are very limited ebooks or ePub formats or ebook formats available that provides interactivity. The concept of interactivity in ebooks can be a revolutionary idea, but it should be implemented properly. So the usage of Aakash Tab or similar other devices that are used by students will be very beneficial for this, for getting the maximum benefit from the interactive ebooks. ePub is a format that provides interactivity. ePub is still in development phase and in near future certain more features may be added to this format. So we can explore ePub format in a broader way to get more features. So these are the conclusions or the pages that I referred. Thank you.